I'm just telling sister right here, she said, Howie, I said, I'm excellent because God is excellent. You don't have to be excellent. You don't have to feel all right, but God is good. God is righteous. God is excellent. So therefore, you being clothed in his righteousness. Y'all don't hear me. Yeah. God is good. God is good. Even when we aren't, because we aren't. We think we're good. We try to be good, but God is good. Amen. God is so good. And I thank God for each and every one of you being here today. Amen. This morning's scripture is coming from Psalms 27. And the word says, "The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid?" I don't care what happened Tuesday. We shouldn't be afraid of anything. We shouldn't be afraid of anything because we all voted for Christ Jesus. We all accepted Christ Jesus. We all know who our king is, who our president is, and God is in control of everything. And we keep saying that, beloved, but we have to believe it. You have to walk like that. Don't put a frown on your face. Don't let nothing discourage you from the blessings that God has for you. Don't let nothing discourage you from what you should be doing in God's kingdom for someone else. We need to uplift some people. Amen. We need to walk around here like we know that God is in control, that God is going to make a way. Listen, all through the Bible we see people that are in control of certain lands, but God is in control of everything. Oh, we got a king. What was his name? Nebuchadnezzar? Let us pray. I'm not preaching this morning, but I'm ready. I'm just ready. Amen. Let us pray. Eternal God, our Father, we come to you right now, thanking you, Lord, for this day. Thank you, Father God, for your grace and your new mercies. Father, we bow down and worship you and praise you in spirit and in truth, Father God. Lord, we just shout hallelujah because you woke us up this morning. You brought us to this place, your house of worship, Father God. And we're going to give you all praise, honor, and glory, Father God. We just thank you this morning, Father God, for what you're doing, Father God. We thank you for being our God, Father God. We thank you for belonging to you, Father God. We thank you for sitting high and looking low. We thank you for making a way out of no way, Father God. We thank you for picking us up, Father God. We thank you for dusting us off, Father God. We thank you for just turning us around and putting us on the right path, Father God, because we are seeking and searching after you, Father God. You are the one that we seek, Father God, in all things, Father God. Your kingdom, Father God. Your statutes, Father God. We want your will to be done, Father God. Lord, we just ask you to give us the strength and the ability to do your will, Father God. Father God, we're asking that you bless this household right here, Father God, and the man that you place, Father God. We ask that you bless Pastor Sanders right now in the name of Jesus, Father God. Give him the strength, Father God. Continue, Father God, to walk with him through the vision that you've placed in him. Father God, bless his family, Father God. Give them strength. Give them healing, Father God. Protect them in all things, Father God. Lord, then bless this congregation, Father God. Someone's going through, Father God, and you know. But let us be a body, Father God. Let us be one body, Father God. help each other, Father God, and pray for one another, Father God, where we are weak, build us up. Father God, we need you right now. This country needs you right now. This world needs you, Father God. Lord, we just need you, and we thank you, Father God, for who you are. We thank you, Father God, because we know you've never made a mistake, and we know that you are perfect, Father God. So, Lord, let us be perfect as we serve you, Father God. Help us to be better than we were the day before, Father God. And, Lord, just put a word in our hearts to spread and give to others. Bless this worship service and the one that's going to bring the word, Father God. Give them the strength to stand boldly on your word. And then let us receive that word, Father God, and go out and do it. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Praise the Lord, everybody. How can you not clap after that? Praise the Lord, everybody. God is good all the time and all the time. Worship time. Anybody in here love music? Well, I'm so glad you said yes, because I need a choir this morning. Hey, this is corporate worship, amen? So if you ever wanted to sing, today is your moment. Just as Brother read, the Lord is my light and my salvation.
Thank you.
because he's everlasting, I will wait on you. It's okay to wait. It builds character. It builds confidence. I will trust in you. Mercies has never failed me. I look back on some of the things that I shouldn't have made it out of. And sometimes all you can say is, thank you, God. Before we go into another song for praise and worship, I always read God's word. I want you all to know, I told the pastor this, that when I accepted this role, I told God, I said, I would never stand up here in flesh, that I must die to self, because I believe that anyone that stands on this stage is responsible for the moment. And if I'm not right, that transfers. And the Lord looks at me because I was responsible. So I was in God's, and the Lord gave me this testimony that I had forgotten all about, because he's so good. When you're in trouble, or you had some trouble, you forgot all about it because he delivered you so well. But the testimony that I have is very applicable to the next song that we will sing very quickly. True story. I was at a gas station a few years ago, and I was waiting on a church group because we were going out of town to go to a concert and sing at this church concert. And I'm sitting under a tree. The sun is coming up. So it's about 6:30 in the morning. Beautiful breeze. I'm in a blue SUV. I had a blue SUV at the time. Had the windows down. Beautiful breeze. Listening to Christian music. And there was a gentleman that was pumping gas. And he kept looking at me. And he looked at me. He looked at me. And as a lady, you know, you think, oh, I hope he doesn't want to come over here and talk to me, right? That's kind of what you think. But he kept looking at me. And I was like, oh, no, he's going to get a rude awakening, and I'm not interested. So he comes my way with his vehicle, and he blocks me in. And I'm thinking, oh, he really wants my number to block me in like this. And he opens up his door, and he pulls a gun on me. And I'm taken back by it because I'm just sitting under the tree listening to music. I know I don't know him, and he certainly didn't know me. And I'm sitting there, and I'm my father's child. I begin to get a little angry. Because I'm like, why is he pulling a gun on me? And the Holy Spirit's like, no, he's not playing with you. And I'm sitting there, I'm like, okay, let me fix my face. He's cutting me out. He's saying perverse things. The Holy Spirit was saying to me, you're in a blue car, he's in a red car. Usually on the streets, the woman to set up a man. I think he thought that I was scoping him out, and that made him paranoid. So I'm sitting there thinking, how am I going to get out of this? And so people start coming into the gas station, and he drives off, and I'm thinking, okay, good. The Holy Spirit's like, no, go. He's circling back to come get you. So I hop on the service road going 100 miles per hour, and he's chasing me at 100. He wanted me badly. Then this big 8-wheeler comes off the highway onto the service road, and he serves as an obstruction to me and the gentleman. And I'm scared because I don't know where to go. You know, service road is open field. You know, it's just me and him. But I come up to a car dealership, and I'm thinking, well, 6:30 in the morning, it's not open. But I turn into the driveway, and the gate happened to be open. And then on the side were three other blue SUVs in a vacant parking space. So I turn very quickly in there and back up, turn my lights off. I see the 18-wheeler go. And then I see the young man go looking to see where I went with his gun in the air. And he couldn't find me. And he kept driving and kept going. And I sat there. And tears began to fall down my eyes. And all I could say was, Lord, I thank you. You are good. 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 Ladies and gentlemen, I don't know what you're going through today. Maybe nothing, but he's so good even in spite of. Even in the good times, the Bible said, give him thanks. I don't care if people are talking about you. I don't care if the doctors, what their report says. He is good. And because of that, Lord, I praise you. If that's somebody's testimony, you are good. Oh, this is your moment to shout about it. Lord, I praise you. You are good. Lord, I praise you. You're so good. Lord, I verse with me. It says simply, Lord, I love you. Lord, I love you. You are good. Lord, I love you. You are good. This is selfish praise because I know what he's done for me. Lord, I love you. You are good. Lord, I thank you. You are good. Lord, I bless you.
give God a hand clap of praise. Amen. All over the place. Well, we can do better than that. Wait a minute, that'd be okay if it was for the Cowboys. How many people know he's really good? Let's give God a hand clap of praise. And all God's people said amen. At this time now, let me just say this. How many people know that it was the Lord that woke him up this morning? One of my relatives, I don't want to call their name because they're watching, but they're in bed. And I said, well, what's wrong? They said, because of the election. And they said, Pastor, they said, brother, I don't know how I'm going to make it. My brother-in-law, even from, if you're watching, I'm going to tell it, he from New Mexico. He said, is this a nightmare? I said, brother, I'm not worried. You know why? Because in the morning, I pray he wakes me up. Are you with me? That there's still an old rugged cross. That's a symbol of suffering and shame. That he died for my sins. It's not in the hands of the White House. It's in the hands of God's. God's in control, amen? So let us not worry about who's elected, amen? Let's worry about serving God, a true and living God, who woke us up early this morning and started us on our way. God is an awesome God. Let's give God a hand clap of praise, because he's worthy to be praised. Yes, he is. He's worthy to be praised. Let us now, at this time, let us go and greet at least three people. Amen. Give me some marching music. Amen. Song, and I think about how many times it was late in the midnight hour that he turned it around. Give God a hand clap of praise. We can't praise him enough. I don't know if you're here today and you need God to do a turnaround. Don't you know he can? Don't you know he will? Late in the midnight hour, God is gonna turn it around. God is good. Amen. Thank you, God. If there be anyone on the other side of the door, let them come forth at this time. We thank God for being the God that he is. I like to say that, let me tell you, John Cooper's in the house. Come on now. John, just stand up and wave, for we have a celebrity in the house. John Cooper, amen. God bless you. Also, we have some birthdays in the house. Anybody who's born in November, would you stand? Y'all remain standing. Okay. November babies. Oh, okay. Well, every month my birthday. Every month. You may be seated. We want just to wish you a very happy birthday. Amen. I didn't see baby swing over there. I see birthday. Amen. We thank God for another day to be alive. Amen. Another year. God is an awesome God. Let me say before Sister Tamika come again, let me just say that how privileged I am and present to some and introduce to others to have a long time, a great friend, a great mentor, and a great big brother, and none other than the Reverend A.K. Haynes. From the Bethany Baptist Church, Missionary Baptist Church, Dallas, Texas. We're so grateful to have. You know, I remember my grandmother used to say that good friends are hard to find. Anybody can attest to that? I want to publicly thank you for being a good friend. And so after Sister Tamika is going to come and she's going to render us a selection, the next voice you hear will be none other than the Reverend A.K. Haynes. Dr. Haynes, this congregation awaits your coming. Oh.
soul is saved. Oh. The Lord, He's so good, and we are safe from harm. I'm safe in the eye of the storm. There is calm.
Father God, we bless your name, we praise you, we adore you, we magnify you. Lord, thank you for your countless blessings. Thank you for the privilege of assembly. Thank you for all of the gifts that you've allowed to be shared. We appreciate this young lady who have poured out of her soul. We thank you, Lord, for your Holy Spirit who leads us and guides us. And so, Master, we ask you now, speak to our hearts that we may speak to these your people. Lord, we want to celebrate you. We want to glorify you, magnify you, lift you up for men to see. Here's our prayer. We ask in the magnificent, marvelous, majestic, miraculous, mighty name of Jesus the Christ, your Son and our Savior. And all the saints said, amen. 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 2 Corinthians chapter 5. 2 Corinthians chapter 5. Verse 21. You need to circle this verse. I don't ever want you to forget it. 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 21. For he hath made him to be sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. For he hath made him, that's Jesus, to be sin for us, that's us, not y'all, that's us, who knew no sin, that we may be made the righteousness of God in him. Look at somebody and say, righteousness of God. Flip over to Isaiah chapter 55. Isaiah chapter 55. That's an Old Testament. Part your Bible in the middle, you ought to be around Psalm. Go a little bit to the right, and you'll run into Isaiah. Chapter 55 and verse 7. 7. Let the wicked forsake his way. And the unrighteous man, his thoughts. And let him return unto the Lord. And he will have mercy upon him. And to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. For my thoughts are not your thoughts. Neither are your ways my ways, said the Lord. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. For a few minutes, I want to talk from the subject, thinking God thoughts. Thinking God thoughts. We praise our God again for the privilege of being here today. I am so thankful and honored to have this invitation from your pastor, friend, and brother beloved. He'd mentioned how we do share very, very special friendship and camaraderie. He is one of God's blessed men. You know, a lot of people preach, but you don't find real good people all the time. Unfortunately, God likes to call some crazy people. And all preachers don't act like preachers all the time. And so I bless God for your pastor. He has a very beautiful spirit. He is a very, very genuine person. He is a special person, and I feel blessed and honored that the Lord allowed him to cross my path. Some people just makes your life better, and I'm better because I know Larry Sanders. Amen. Why don't you bless God for your pastor right now? Bless God right now. Yeah. Again, I want to thank this young lady. You've blessed our hearts today. And yeah, that's. I praise God for people who just surrender it all for the Lord, you know. Some people are so busy trying to look cute, they can't praise, you know. And I got a problem with folk who don't like to praise the Lord. Now, I had a little procedure in the hospital a couple of weeks ago, and I hadn't been in the hospital in my life. I went in 1984, and I was in there for a checkup for insurance. And the only reason I'm 74 years old, the only reason I'm still here, the Lord has taken care of me. So I don't want your pity, I want your prayers. I'm going to preach. If I stand up, I'm going to preach. I don't know how much hooping I'm going to do today. How much hooping I hoop today depends on how many amens y'all give me. If y'all don't say many amens, I'm going to get through quick. I ain't going to say a lot. Wait. I ain't going to lie to you. If you want the sermon to get through quick, you better say amen. Yeah. If you don't say amen, we're going to be up here a while. I might be sick, but I can go 2 hours with no problem. Yeah. That verse I told you about in 2 Corinthians, it is a very significant verse in my life. He says, "For God has made him, Jesus, to take on our sin." Jesus, who knew no sin, was made to take on our sins. Jesus was perfect. He didn't commit any sins. But the Bible said God so loved us that he sent Jesus for us. So when he died on the cross, he was representing you and me. He didn't do anything wrong, but he was suffering because of what we've done wrong. He suffered for us before us were us. He died for us before we even were alive. And so we are indebted to Christ. But I want you to get this part. He says we were made righteous in him. I like the way he put it. He said, in him we have the righteousness of God. The right. Look at somebody say the righteousness of God. Yeah. In other words, because of Jesus, you and I are the righteousness of God. He didn't say you're going to be righteous. We are already the righteousness of God. Why? Because Jesus paid it all. Yeah. So I think you need to understand, if you're going to be the person God would have you to be, you need to learn how to start thinking godly. Start thinking God thoughts. In other words, you say, I don't want you thinking just any kind of thing. You know, the devil likes you to get up thinking about you. You know, you think about your big toe hurt and you had a bad day. And you know what? 99.5% of the time, if you start thinking about you in the morning, you're going to have a messed up day all day long. Because the more you think about you, the more messed up you're going to get. No. So that you've got to learn, if you really want to have a good day, you need to start thinking about God. If you want to have a good day, think God thoughts. Think God thoughts. My thoughts are not your thoughts. My ways are not your ways. He says, so you need to learn how to think like God. I can't think God thoughts and have negative reactions. Do I have a witness here? Let me start talking about the redeeming work. Redeeming work is that you understand what he did was he did it to redeem us. When God created Adam, he put him in a garden. God put Adam in a perfect environment. He had anything he could possibly want. All the food he could want, all of the environment. I mean, that's nothing. You know how much you have to pay when you go to the grocery store for some fruit? And Adam just went around plucking stuff, you know. I mean, he had all. Had greens and cabbage. He had everything. I mean, he had nothing to complain about. And then God says, I'm going to let you name all that. You can do whatever you want. Don't mess it up. But I got one tree. One tree. I don't want you to eat that tree Because if you eat from that tree, it's going to mess you up. Now look at that. He has everything he could possibly have, and he makes the mistake of listening to the devil. And when he listened to the devil caused him to question God. He decided he wanted to eat this fruit to be like God. He just fruit to know what God knows. And the devil loves to tell you, he knows how to mix the truth with the lie. He said, in other words, you're going to start thinking some stuff that God thinks, but what you're going to learn, you really don't want to. When he ate the fruit, he died. God said, the day you eat this fruit, you will surely die. But Reverend, he didn't die right away. He started dying. No. When he ate the fruit, he died. In fact, he didn't die when he ate the fruit. He died the split second he decided he was going to eat the fruit. Yeah. Let me redefine death for you, because y'all thinking he was still alive. He still had a body, but he was dead. I want you in the lifetime, replace the word death with the word separation. Instead of saying dying, death, say separation. You see, when you die, you really don't die. You just separate. You are separate. Your body is separated from your soul, your spirit. Yeah, y'all looking at me like y'all didn't know that. All you folk who like to go to the graveyard and pray over your mama, you crazy. I don't mean you crazy. Keep doing what you're doing, but you do know mama ain't there. That's not where your mama live. I ain't went. Now, the only time I went to my mama's grave when I had to do go to the graveyard to bury somebody, and it was close to my mama's grave, and I just went on there to check to see if she was still, her name was still over there, nobody ain't stole her. I'm not going to no graveyard to see nobody. Why? They don't live there, baby. They're not there. Then when they died, their spirits were separated from their bodies. Absent from the body, present with the Lord. When Adam ate the fruit, he was spiritually separated from God. He was spiritually dead. He was dead. He was dead. He wasn't asleep. He was dead. All right? No. When Adam died, Adam represented the law. God gave him a law. He didn't keep it. He died. Sad. On the sixth day, God rested. Rest. Sixth day. What's the sixth day? That's Saturday. Y'all trying to glorify Saturday. Saturday. That was the old Sabbath. The old Sabbath represented the old law. He died. He was separated. Adam. Adam is on Saturday. Now, when Jesus died on the cross, they put him in a grave Friday. But he didn't get up Friday. He could have got up Saturday. He didn't get up Saturday. What day did he get up? Come on here. Oh, y'all been reading, boy. The first day of the week was early. Oh, that'll preach, boy. That's my climax. Y'all should have shouted right there. I know I'm not doing it. Early Sunday morning. Huh? Early Sunday morning. So that when you think about the old man, Adam, Saturday. The new Adam, Sunday. Oh, I wish I had a witness here. The old Adam messed up. The new Adam fixed it up. The old Adam is dead. The new Adam redeemed. See, when Jesus came, he rises on a Sunday morning because he wants you and me to know he redeemed us. Oh, I wish I had a witness. See, when you're honest about it, that's why the law, he said, God says the old law was nothing but a school teacher to teach us that we can't keep it.
See, that's why I have a short patience with these holier than thou folk. Who are trying to fool somebody like they don't. I wish I had a witness up in here. Ain't no sense you coming in here trying to act like ain't nothing wrong with you. Ain't no sense you rolling your eyes at me like you better than me. Negro, you aren't any better than I am. You might have some different dirt, but you still got dirt. You might not smell like me, but you still stinking. We all in the same category. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Don't come in here trying to judge me. You better pick somebody else. You better ask somebody. He comes to redeem us so that in Christ, I know I can't keep the law, but in Christ I am the righteousness of God. In the devil, I'm a sinner. Now, when you wake up in the morning and you don't have God thoughts, it's probably because you've been listening to the other guy. And when the devil talks to you, he's not trying to help you. He's trying to mess you up. He wants to depress you. He wants to belittle you. He wants to tell you about what you used to do. I wish I had a witness here. He wants to tell you about your past sins. He wants to tell you about that night that you don't want to talk about, but you remember all the time. You know when you really feel holy and you're feeling good in church and he brings to your mind when you did that you don't want to talk about in church and all your spirit just dwindles away? That's because you allow the devil to contaminate your thoughts. He said you don't let the devil contaminate your thinking. You ought to think like God. And when I think like God, I start off being righteous. Well, Reverend, what you're trying to say, that God's going to let me do whatever I want to do and I get away? No. When I start thinking like God, I start off right. I'm righteous, but not only am I righteous in God, the power of God give me the strength to live righteously. He gives me the strength to walk right and talk right. And think right. He tells me, whenever you start thinking about what you're not supposed to think about, you know what I'm talking about. You know what I'm talking about. You see that fine sister looking all good, and, you know, them little horns start coming up. But that God thought, say, oh, time out. You got to straighten that thing out. And he start leading you. Another way, do I have a witness here? If you love the Lord, say amen. Yeah. Okay, I said, did redeem in the work. In other words, we've been redeemed. All the work of our redemption was done by God through Christ. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believed as have faith in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. I could stay there all day. I could preach that thing, boy. Y'all better be glad I'm sick today. If I wasn't sick, I'd preach. Not only do I see redeeming works, I also see returning to the word. Returning to the word. Looking at somebody and say, the word. Yeah. In the beginning was the word, and the word was with God, and the word was God. Without him was not anything made. That when you start talking about the word, you know you're talking about Jesus. That's what John say. He is the living word. I wish I had a witness. Now, if I want to start thinking God thoughts, how am I going to think God thoughts? How am I going to? He's already told me he's higher than I am. He's superior to me. How am I, my little pea brain, how is it supposed to comprehend a higher way of thinking? Well, if I'm going to think God thoughts, I'm going to have to start spending some time with God. That's some deep stuff. Y'all should have shouted right then. I can't really think God thoughts and I don't want to pray. I can't think God thought and I don't want to talk to God. And then one of the problems y'all have, y'all think prayer is talking to God. And I told you before, you need to spend less time talking and more time listening. More time listening. See, sometimes prayer ought to be quiet. Sometimes you ought to just be there, they call it meditating. Sometimes you ought to just be there, just taking it in. See what God wants to say to you. See what God, how he wants to talk to you. David said, thy word has I hid in my heart that I may not sin against thee. Thy word is a light, come on here somebody, to my feet. Yeah. I've got to come to grips with that. If I know God and spend time with God, I start dealing some time in his word. His word. I mean, it's not all that myth, because some of y'all can't pray. Lord, if the Lord told you something, you wouldn't hear. Poor babies, y'all. God could be screaming and you wouldn't even know God talking to you. You so disconnected. But the good news is that even when you that disconnected spiritually, all you got to do is open up your Bible. Come on here, somebody, and start reading. And guess what's in here? God's word. Yeah. Instead of memorizing all that other stuff, that hip hop, memorize God's word. Oh, don't get wrong. There's some spiritual hip hop. There's some holy hip hop, but you won't know the difference if you don't spend some time in God's word. I got to read His word. David said, "Have I hid in my heart that I might not sin against God?" I got to know his word. And so when I read his word and I study his word will help me to know what God's thoughts are. And when I know God's thoughts, I start thinking like God. I start thinking like, wow. Do you know what it is to think like God? I want to think like God. God, talk to me. Wow. I don't think like the devil. I want to think like God. I want to start thinking on a higher level. We look at the text. He said the wicked needs to change their ways, but he says the unrighteous need to change their thoughts. See the distinction? See, you can change your ways, he said, but you know what? I found out before you start trying to change your ways, you need to change your thoughts. I wish I had a witness here. Yeah. It starts with your thinking. It starts with your thinking. A lot of y'all messed up because your thinking is messed up. You're unhappy because your thinking is all messed up. You thinking the world revolves around you when it's not even about you. It's all about him. It's not about where you work. It's not about what school you attended. It's not about your degrees. It's not about your money. It's not about your privilege and prestige. No. It's really all about God. I wish I had a witness here. I heard the preacher say, it was the Lord who woke me up this morning. The Lord who started me on my way. You know, you can have all the money in the world, and if God don't shake you and wake you up, you're going to leave all of it here for us. You can have all the friends where they can talk about how great a person. They come to your funeral and lie till the sun go down, and you still can bust hell wide open. It's really all about the Lord. It's all about God. If I can understand God, if I can start thinking godly thoughts, if I can focus my mind on him, How do you focus your mind on God and be depressed? You know, how do you focus your mind on God? You know, everybody talking about, well, you know, you need some therapy, you know. And I think I ought to say this, some of y'all do. But you know what I found out? I found out if you spend enough time with God, that's all the therapy you gonna need. If you spend enough time with God, you don't have to worry about no depression. If you spend enough time with God, you don't have to worry about thinking your life is coming to end. You don't have to worry about no suicide. What you gonna kill yourself for? When I know if God gave me life, come on here, somebody. He knows how to call me when it's time for him to call me home. I need to understand. I need to lean on him and depend on him. We need to go back to God's word. We got so sophisticated. We got so much stuff in church now, we can do everything and all. But the word seems like it's lost. You know, I've been to these functions, and you go in there, man, they start off with a devotion. You know, and devotion, not devotion. Now, they have a praise period. You know, I got a problem with a praise period. See, you say, I'm going to praise it, period. Praise is over now. Well, when I was a boy, praise period was all morning. Amen. Amen. Praise period was when church started till a benediction. Amen. And the more people I went to church with, sometimes when the benediction was pronounced, they didn't care. They were still shouting. People leaving and going home, they didn't care. They were still giving God some praise because they didn't have a praise period. They had a praise person. They wasn't praising a period. They was praising a relationship. They were praising because they got somebody to praise. And see, some of y'all can't praise him because you don't know him. You can't praise him because you don't know who he is. You better ask somebody who he is. Yeah, you better. The word says you need to know who you believe in. You've got too many folk come to church, don't even know what they believe in, who they believe in. They don't know what they believe in. They don't know that you got to know God is God. And beside him there is none other. You need to know that God really don't care whether you Methodist, Baptist, Church of God in Christ, sanctified. No, he doesn't care about all these labels y'all come up with. No. He wants to know, do you know him? Paul said that I might know him and the power of his resurrection, that I might know him and know the suffering that he encountered, that I can know him. Oh, if I know him, the rest of it is elementary. If I know him, I can walk with a pep in my step. If I know him, he can put running in my feet and clapping in my... If I know him... That's all I need. That's all I need. I'm going to let y'all go. Y'all know I can stay there. I got to return to the word because when I return to the word, my problem is I love the word. See, preacher, I found out, you know, I love the word more than my people love the word. So when I'm preaching, I get excited about the word and they want to go home. I'm excited about the word. They think about cowboys. That might be why the Lord has punished. He He's talking about y'all new president. I wasn't sure what God was going to do. But you do understand God is still in control. I'm not scared of nobody. I ain't worried about what's going to happen to me. Because I know God got me. I'm just concerned about some of the rest of y'all. All these Uncle Tom dark people talking about how great Dump is and how great a man he is. Don't you know that you got to pay for all them lies? Don't you know you got to pay for America? America has become a contaminated place. You know what messed the devil up? Talking about the devil, he let pride take over. You know what's wrong with America? America has allowed pride to take over. You know, one of the worst traits of the devil is he's greedy. You know what's wrong with a lot of folk? Greedy. Don't y'all look at me like you don't know what I'm talking about. You know, greedy. I'm 74. They ask me, are you married? No. You looking for a wife? Yeah, I'm looking for a woman who loves me for me and not for what I got. Do you know how many gold diggers they got in the world? And I think I ought to tell you, they're not all female. You got some men gold diggers too? Oh, help me, Holy Ghost. I might as well preach today. Yeah, you know. And you more worried about stuff than you are people? You going to pay for all this? You giving money to the rich. Talking about it's going to trickle down. Nobody care nothing about poor people. You see all these fools they're talking about, well, what we going to do to straighten out the Democrats? Forget the Democrats. What you going to do to straighten out you? The Democrats ain't the only one. All these commentators lying. How in the devil y'all say Biden lost the debate? And Biden is telling you what he thinks, giving you facts to support what he thinks. This other fool, all he doing is sitting up there, standing up there lying. And you got nerve enough talking about he won a debate. What is wrong with you? What's wrong with your logic? You know, he's slow. He can't think. Who you know 80 years old ain't slow? I'm 74 years old. I'm not as fast as I used to be. But I ain't ready for nobody to retire me. No, when God called me, I'm ready to go. You ain't got to beg me not to stay. I'll be glad to go. But you need, you know, y'all need to get off of this mess. And you got all this junk. And they lying out sitting there talking, oh, well, you know, it's about time they do it. Well, you know, it's a shame he waited so long before he stepped down. Really? We love greed. We love money. We love to take care of the rich. And we think there are no consequences to our actions. Galatians chapter 6. Be not deceived. God is not mocked. Whatsoever man, whatever you plant, that shall you also reap. I'm sorry, I didn't mean to say all that. Y'all made me do that. I didn't mean that. Let me close. I want to close out talking about reaping the wealth. Reaping the wealth. Reaping the wealth. That I like that word, reaping. I got
to clean out my horns in case I got to blow. Reaping the wealth that I have to come to grips with. This God we served loves us so much that he sent his son Jesus to pay our debts. Wish I had a witness here. But not only did he send Jesus, he says, I will pardon you. I will forgive you. I will abundantly pardon you. Y'all don't hear me. That's some good news. That's some good news. That reaping would suggest a process. You can't reap if you haven't already. Ooh, somebody been reading that. Y'all been listening there. You can't reap if you haven't planted. See, God doesn't have a problem with you being rich. God has a problem with you looking for some money and you haven't planted anything. He got a problem with you looking for a crop and you aren't planting anything. He got a problem with you not doing what you're supposed to do. And you expecting God to just rain down stuff. Oh, I wish I had a witness here. Oh, no. Before you start asking God to give you some things, you need to check out what you're supposed to do. Do I have a witness here? I want God to bless me, but I don't want to do anything. God, give me a job. Get your butt out the bed. Yeah. Get me a job. You want a job, but you don't want to do it. You won't get out the bed. You don't fill out any application. You won't knock on any doors. You want God to just drop a job in your lap. And you feel like everything will be all right. I got favor. And since I got favor, God gonna bless me. He gonna bless you all right. He gonna slap you upside your head. I'm saying there's a reaping coming. You need to understand, when God gets ready to start giving some crops for all this mess, America gonna be a changed place. All these people riding on their high horse. Yeah, I wish I had a witness here. Yeah. All you folk who think you can throw dirt and nothing come back on you, I got some news for you. Be not deceived. God is not mocked. That stuff is coming back. All y'all been gossiping and lying on folk and thinking they ain't gonna ever come back and stick to you. Be not deceived. God is not mocked. You've been talking about everybody else's skeletons in their closet, like your closet is locked and nobody can get in. Be not deceived. God is not mocked. Whatsoever you sow, whatever you plant, it's coming up again. Do I have a witness here? What I liked about the Lord, if you really love the Lord, I wish I had a witness here. If you really trust the Lord, look what he said. He says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever, come on here, somebody. You know what I'm talking about, that word believe? That word believe has to do with faith. Do I have a witness here? What he told us in Hebrew, he said, faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. In other words, if you can see it, come over here, somebody. God ain't got nothing to do with it. If God has anything to do with it, you can't see it. I wish I had a witness here. Faith is a risk factor. I can't really
exercise faith without taking some action. I said something then that you can't have faith and lock it up. It's just going to stay still. No. Faith means I got to do something. Faith means I've got to make a transition. I've got to make some changes. I can't trust in it. If I don't have some faith in it. But I can't trust in it. I wish I had a witness here. If I can see it, you don't trust in that. Because if I see it, it's not of God. Now, you can doubt in stuff you see. I listened to Joe today. He says you can doubt things that you don't have faith in. And the way you deal with doubt, don't be ashamed when you doubt. He said, but when the devil comes to you and throw you some doubt, he said, you got to learn how to doubt the devil's doubt. The devil is trying to make you doubt. And so when he throws doubt at you, you tell him, I doubt your doubt. And he said, well, you can't doubt my doubt. I gave you my doubt. He said, but your doubt ain't all that good. Your doubt is doubtful. So I doubt your doubt. If you can put doubt in the right place and you can start walking by faith, your faith will make a difference in your life. Y'all looking at me like y'all hear me. Y'all better stop thinking, trying to be logical and intellectual and think, I'm sorry, I got to see it. I got to be able to put my hands on. Baby, there is nothing significant in kingdom building that you can put your hands on. There's nothing in kingdom building that you can see. I've got to learn how to walk by the Spirit. Walk by faith, let the Lord have way in my life. Oh, y'all getting sleepy. Let me close out then. Well, my brothers and sisters, he says, I will reward you. I'll pardon you and I will forgive your sins. Do I have a witness here? Well, that's something right there. I've got to understand, first of all, I've been talking about relationship. Yeah, you can't be who you're supposed to be unless you recognize you've got to have the proper relationship with God. My relationship is based on the fact, yes, that he died for my sins. He loved me so much, he sent his only begotten son to die in my stead. So that when God saved me, yeah, that was it. The relationship was formed. Nothing will change the relationship. Nothing's gonna stop God from being my father and from me being his son. Yeah, I'm in good relationship because he redeemed my soul and he walks with me and talks with me and I am in good relationship. Because you lie on me don't change the relationship. Because I don't wear a black suit on first Sunday don't change the relationship. Because a church vote me out don't change the relationship. The relationship is fixed and my mind is made up. But not only do I need relationship, I also need some fellowship. Yeah, I can't change the relationship, but the fellowship can get contaminated if you allow the devil to interfere with your relationship. He'll try to contaminate your fellowship. You can tell when you're out of fellowship with God. How can I tell, preacher, you sit up in church and don't say nothing? When you're out of fellowship, you don't feel anything. When you're out of fellowship, you can't feel the Holy Ghost. When you're out of fellowship, the devil will mess with your joy. Yeah, he'll mess with your peace. Yeah, he'll mess with your happiness. happiness because you're out of fellowship with the Lord. But if you know how to trust in the Lord and lean not unto your own understanding, if you know how to just allow the Lord to have his way in your life, yes, he'll guide your footsteps. He'll walk with you, and he'll talk with you. Read the rest of it. It's right there in that verse. He said, I'll give you joy. I'll give you peace. I'll give you happiness. I feel sorry for y'all who feel like you got to be all stuck up and stiff-necked in order to be a Christian. You better learn how to enjoy yourself. You better learn how to praise him for what he has done. Praise him for what he is doing. Praise him for what he's going to do. You better learn how to lift him up and give him some praise, because the Lord, he deserves our praise. The Lord, he deserves our admiration. The Lord, he deserves our giving him all that he's due. Because if you really know him, you got to love him. If you really know him, you got to give him his. If you really know him, he can really brighten up your life. He can make a way out of no way. He can open doors that no man can shut. He can put a roof over your head. He can bring sunshine into your darkness. He's all right. He's able to lift up a bowed down head. He's all right. He's worthy to be praised. If you know him, say yeah. Say yeah. Say yeah. I know the Lord. I know he's all right. He's worthy to be praised. Ain't he all right? Ain't he all right? Yeah! Yeah!
All heads bowed, all eyes closed. If you're here today, say, Brother Preacher, I'm here and I heard what you said, but I don't know God for myself. I'm here. I never had that kind of encounter you're talking about. I'm here. I want to be saved, but I don't know how to be saved. If you're here today and you need to know that, if you want to know that, just raise your hand wherever you are. Raise your hand. Raise your hand. If you're here, raise your hand. Say, but preacher, I'm here. Came to church today and I've been helped today, but my membership is not. It's not set. I've been going church after church after church, and I don't really have a home church. You need to have a relationship with your church so you can be accountable to somebody for your stewardship. You can be accountable for whether you're growing, be accountable for whether you're studying. You're accountable for whether you're attending prayer service and Bible study and Sunday school and worship, you want to be accountable. If you're here today and you want You need a church home. You need a church home. Raise your hand. You read. Raise your hand. I see you. I see you. I see you. If you're here today, say, "Brother Preacher, I got a church. I'm good standing with God. I'm saved. I know that I'm saved, but I'm going through a storm right now. I'm going through a storm right now. I'm going through a storm. I need some prayer. I need somebody to pray with me. I need somebody to help me. I need somebody to help me. Your counselor? Your counselor? Okay, I need somebody to help me. I need somebody to walk with me. I need somebody to walk with me." If you're here today and you want special prayer, you want us to pray with you, whatever your need is, whatever your needs are, we'll be willing to pray with you and pray for you. We'll pray with you and pray for you, whatever your needs are. If you're here today, if you're here today. But preacher, I want to pray for somebody who's not here. They need salvation, but they don't even believe in God. And the Bible says if they don't believe in God, they can't be saved. But then Jesus says the impossible is possible with God. So I want to pray in their stead. I want to pray for their souls. Even though they say they don't want God, I want to pray that God will save them. If you are here and you want to pray for somebody's salvation, somebody else, you want to pray for somebody else, you want to pray for somebody who's going through. Okay. So God is still talking. The Spirit is still moving. You know who you are. It's nothing wrong with coming to church. And not joining church. It's nothing wrong with coming to church and leaving, but seem like to me there ought to be a response to the word. There should be a response to the word. If I want to reap the wealth of the word, I've got to be willing to plant the seeds of the word. I don't want our assembling to be in vain. I want us to just glorify God. I want God to get the glory from all of our being here. If you're here today, you got a need. You got something that you got on your. You got something we need to deal with. I haven't even touched on it. I don't know. You know what you and God going through. You know what it's all about. If you want to come, you can come right now. Come on, Pastor. Come on, Pastor.
God's people said amen. You may be seated. Let's give God a hand clap of praise. Amen. Amen. Let's praise God for the messenger and the message. We thank God. Thank you, Pastor, so much. This time now, we have some very special announcements, and I pray that you'll come at this time. Thank you, Brother Adler.
Good morning, Keller Springs Church family. It's always a blessing to be here in the house of the Lord. This is where we honor, praise, and worship Him. These are your announcements for Sunday, November 10th. The new members class will continue next Sunday at 9:30 a.m. in Fellowship Hall. So if you are a new member, please join us. however, this will be our last session for the year, but you are still welcome to attend next Sunday at 9:30. Our prayer service will be this Wednesday, November 13th at 7 p.m., Zoom only. Please join us as we volunteer for the MetroCrest Services Annual Drive, Thanksgiving Distribution Day, and that's on Saturday, November 23rd. There are three time slots that we must fill: 8:30 a.m. to 11 a.m., 10:30 a.m. to 1 p.m., 12:30 a.m. to 3 p.m. 12:30 p.m. to 3 p.m. Sign-up sheets are in the church lobby. Come out November 23rd and support this community event hosted by our own KSBC Deacons Ministry. You can see any deacon for more information. The KSBC School Partnership and Community Outreach Ministry is proud to present the Angel Tree Program for 2024. We are excited to bless 30 children in need at the Carrollton Elementary School. And we have 30 children. There will be a sign-up sheet in the front lobby to choose which angels you want to bless. Also, if you, our own KSBC members and friends, if you have a child in need, let us know so that we can add them to the list. You can drop off your unwrapped gifts in a large bag every Sunday before and after church. Please place the child's name on the outside of the bag. And if you're not interested in shopping, we will take donations as well. Amen. All gifts are due by Sunday, December 15th, and we will deliver the gifts to the school on Wednesday, December 18th. Now we've got 6 weeks left for the Steps of Faith Challenge, and it's still not too late to join and give your pledge. Please make it today by visiting the announcement email page and choose your pledge. Our final event is scheduled for December 31st by the challenge team. So that's New Year's Eve, and I'm sure it's going to be very exciting. Amen. Now, it's been 57 years, and we are celebrating our church anniversary next Sunday. November 17th at 10:30 a.m. We are united in faith and guided by grace. And we have a special announcement regarding the anniversary. But I don't see Brother Gary, so you do know, at least you know, that we will be celebrating next Sunday. These have been your announcements. Thanks for listening, and many blessings.
And all God's people say amen. Next Sunday, we will celebrate. Thank you. Now, I'm not going to forget that money, bro. No. Oh, no. Thank you so much, Deacon. But next Sunday will be a very special day. We will be celebrating 57. I keep rushing it. 57 years as a church, and we will have our special guest, the Reverend Dr. Tedry Woods, will be bringing the message on that Sunday. Amen. We are Peacock proud, hyena happy, to be thankful, to be in a church where God has blessed us and keeping us. And all we have to do is look around, and we see the goodness of God. Amen. Amen. I want to take this time. I was always told that I want to finish well, that whatever I was doing, that I should try and finish well. We embarked on our steps of faith, and simply that's what it was, a step of faith. Amen. There are some say we can't get there. Some are saying it now. But look where we are. Look where we are. I want you to turn to somebody and say, we can do it. Turn to somebody else and say, God can do it. Amen. So we know that with God's help, we can do it. Amen. I want to thank, look at our youth ushers. Just give God a hand clap of praise for them. Boy, now you have them right in line. Praise God. We thank you so much for your service. At this time now, let us come prepare for our giving. John Cooper. The grace of God and the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit. May it rest, may it rule with us now and forevermore. Let all God's people say, amen. You're dismissed.
Pentecost had fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting. Verse 4, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Just like he did it before. How many know we need him to do it again? All right, here we go. Just